it's a beauty.
I'm the beauty. I'm the beast. I'm the beast.
I'm the beauty.
I'm the beauty. I'm the beast. I'm the beast.
I'm the beauty.
I'm the beauty. I'm the beast. I'm the beast. I'm the beauty and the beast. Welcome to Teacup for One.
My name is Matt, and I have 2 degrees. And today we're talking about one of the greatest Disney villains, if not one of the greatest Disney characters of all time. I am, of course, talking about the title character of Beauty and the Beast, Gaston. Now, I will admit I'm a little biased in thinking Gaston's awesome. Now, first, I'll just get this out of the way. Yes. Obviously, Belle is meant to be the beauty in the title, and the beast is meant to be the beast, but the title is absolutely a double entendre and speaks to how crucial and how important Gaston is in Disney's reworking of this classic story. Now, as I'm sure you know, Disney is famous for their track record of reworking stories from their source material when adapting them into feature animated films, especially when it comes to the villains. For example, in the original Little Mermaid, the Sea Witch is just a businesswoman, nothing else. She shows up once, she makes the deal, she gives the mermaid her legs, and then she has no personal involvement or stake in whether or not the mermaid stays a human. In the original Sleeping Beauty, the evil fairy just shows up at the baby baptism, they force her to eat off of the cheap china, she curses the baby, she bounces, and then that's it for her. And in the original Hunchback of Notre Dame, Frollo is actually a priest and not a judge, which actually makes the story a whole lot better. But that's none of my business. For the most part, when Disney adapts a story for an animated feature, their treatment of the villain significantly strengthens the story, except for Hunchback, which significantly weakened it. The funny thing with Beauty and the Beast is that the original story provided almost no villain whatsoever. I mean, there was the enchantress that turned the prince into the beast, who kind of served a similar purpose as the characters that eventually became Ursula and Maleficent. Someone with magic shows up, curses the main character, and then is never heard from again. But the big difference is that in Beauty and the Beast, the enchantress doesn't actually have any active involvement in the story. She casts the spell before we meet any of the characters, and then she's just kind of mentioned at the end as an afterthought. This could actually be why it took so long for Beauty and the Beast to go into production, because Beauty and the Beast was actually on a list of potential fairy tales to adapt by Walt Disney himself right after the success of Snow White. So we're talking like the 1940s, but according to an animator that I watched an interview with, the struggle with Beauty and the Beast was that there wasn't much to the story. It was just a guy asking a girl to marry him at dinner every single night. She would always say no until eventually she said yes. So Beauty and the Beast sat on the shelf for decades until they decided to give it another go in the late 1980s. From what I understand, there's actually an earlier version of the film that went pretty far into production where the main villain was not Gaston, but Belle's evil aunt. I think her name was like Marguerite or Margarine or something. And Gaston still existed in some form as a character, but he was like a very foppish aristocrat and from aristocrat. That really, from the sounds of it, was more of a pawn of Belle's evil aunt than a villain in his own right. Reportedly, that earlier version of the film was entirely scrapped, and the animators were told to start from scratch. And with that, they got rid of Belle's evil aunt, and for their villain, they drew inspiration from an earlier Beauty and the Beast film. When most people think of Beauty and the Beast now, they undoubtedly think of the Disney rendition. But back in 1946, French filmmaker Jean Cocteau directed his own version of the story, which heavily influenced Disney's vision for their film. You can see Cocteau's influence throughout Disney's Beauty and the Beast, ranging from the living furniture to the design of the beast himself. But I think the most important thing that he added to the story was the addition of a character named Avenant. Avenant was a potential suitor to Belle, and by the end of the film, he dies whilst on a personal quest to kill the beast. Sound familiar? Now, this was a genius move on Cocteau's part, because Beauty and the Beast, at its heart, is a love story. So, how do you infuse conflict into a love story? You create a love triangle.
And the math of love triangles is super duper fun.
But the extra genius thing that Cocteau did was he cast the same actor to play the Beast and Avenant. And at the end, when the Beast is transformed into a prince, he takes the form of Avenant. And Avenant turns into a Beast. It's all about duality, really. Disney took this whole idea of duality between the Beast and Gaston, and they turned it into the foundation for their film. And I say Disney, but a lot of the credit should probably go to Linda Wolverton. She was the screenwriter on Beauty and the Beast, but she is so significant because she is the first screenwriter to ever be hired for a Disney animated feature. Prior to that, the story and the script came out of animators collaborating during the storyboarding process. But for this one, they brought on an actual screenwriter, and I think that is so evident when you look at the fact that Beauty and the Beast has one of the strongest scripts of any Disney film possibly ever. This is a screenplay that understands story structure and understands character development on a far deeper level than we'd seen in any Disney film prior. Just for a second, here's a quick refresher on story structure. You have a character. They start off in one place. They go through a series of experiences that ultimately teach them a lesson or transform them into a new type of person. And then they end the story in a completely different place from where they started. That is your protagonist. How do you determine who your protagonist is? Easy. You look at the character who changes the most from start to finish. Then, on the flip side, you have your antagonist, who are kind of acting as a roadblock to your protagonist in so far as achieving their goals and their wants and their needs. In his book, Anatomy of Story, which is an amazing book, John Truby talks about how a well-structured story will have the protagonist and antagonist fighting for the same thing. They have the same want, they have the same need, they have the same goal, but only one of them can get it. And this is why Gaston elevates Beauty and the Beast to an entirely new level, because he is a perfect antithetical mirror to the Beast. It's all about duality. It's no coincidence that on stage, a lot of actors go from playing Gaston to playing the Beast, or vice versa. Except for me. Someone please hire me. I want to be the Beast. Anyway, both of these characters have the same need. Belle. And their pursuit of her is the catalyst for both of their character transformations. The Beast, as he forges an actual relationship with her, becomes more human-like, and Gaston, as he tries to force a relationship with her, becomes more beast-like. And by structuring the story this way, we get something with Gaston that we do not get with any other Disney villain. A character arc. We get to see him become a villain. The biggest misconception with Gaston is that he is evil from the start and that he's stupid, whereas nothing could be further from the truth. First of all, he's not stupid. This is a very highly educated, intelligent individual. He's able to just randomly quote Shakespeare correctly.
Screw your courage to the sticking place.
And that whole scene with Belle where he's looking at the book saying, "How can you read this? There are no pictures." See, that's more about him assuming that women aren't smart enough to be able to read a book unless it has pictures, as opposed to highly educated gentlemen of society like himself. Now, to clarify, I said he wasn't evil from the beginning. I never said he wasn't a problematic jerk. Gaston's tragic flaw is his ego. This is somebody who is good at everything. He is on top of the world. He has never been told no once in his life until he proposes to Belle, and she turns him down. But not only does she turn down his proposal, she rejects him in front of the entire town, and it is a type of humiliation that Gaston has never known before. This is the moment when he starts to unravel, and the hunter instincts kick in, and winning Belle becomes more about saving his reputation than anything else. So, he hatches a plan to have Maurice committed to the Maison des Lunes, hoping that he can put on this big show of swooping in and being Belle's knight in shining armor, saving her father. But she rejects him again and proves that all of her father's crazy ramblings were in fact true. And that whole moment, the Show Me the Beast scene, is the moment when Gaston actually descends into true villainy and becomes evil.
I know he looks vicious, but he's really kind and gentle. He's my friend.
If I didn't know better, I'd think you had feelings for this monster.
He's no monster, Gaston. You are.
Up until this point in the story, he's been acting selfishly just to try to convince Belle to marry him. But when he realizes the Beast is real, he realizes that Belle picked the Beast over him. And then it's not about winning Belle as his wife anymore. It's about actively hurting Belle by hurting the Beast. And because he is so smart and so intelligent and so manipulative, he knows that all it's going to take is a few strong words and a very catchy toe-tapping song to turn the village into an angry mob to take down the thing that Belle picked over him.
Kill the Beast!
No! You do this.
If you're not with us, you're against us.
This is a character who started off on top of the world, intelligent, good-looking, and loved by everyone, but then one rejection bruises his ego to the point where he starts on a downward spiral, transforming him from a beauty to a beast. Well, folks, that concludes yet another episode of Teacup 4-1. Let me know in the comments section down below if there are any other Disney villains that have a similar character arc to Gaston. Any other Disney villains that we get to see descend into villainy on such a grand scale. Or just let me know who your favorite Disney villain is. Or let me know if you think I'm more of a Gaston or a Beast. Thanks for joining us today, everyone. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you haven't subscribed already. It's super easy. All you need to do is click on my face. Thanks for joining us today, everyone. My name is Matt, and I have 2 degrees, and that's the tea cup for one. Go away.